Welcome to COA on the Air, a television show dedicated to our Bedford residents, especially the seniors here in town. A show with up-to-date news for you about what's happening around the town, services offered, and things that matter in your life, making connections and having fun. We'd like to thank the Bedford TV station for hosting us, of course, the Council on Aging, and Progress Software, whose grant has made this show possible. Let me introduce my co-host, Lester Macklin. Hi, Lester.
Hi, Leslie.
How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good.
But you know, some people don't do well. And what happens is they come out of the hospital and they get into their car and they don't know really what's going on.
Uh-oh.
So there is a program that will help them and help everybody else. And it's the Emerson Hospital's Older Driver Initiative. And we have two representatives here to tell us all about it.
Excellent.
All right, we have Michelle Dolan.
Yes.
Hi, Michelle.
Hi.
And Kristen Keelty.
Hi, Kristen.
Hello.
Welcome.
Thank you for having us.
You're very welcome. When adults have a change in their health status, like I said, maybe a heart attack or a stroke or an accident, and they get back into the car, they may not be the same as when they got into the car prior to the problem. So how do you recognize this and what do you do about it?
Well, you know, before they answer that, I have a question. Who are you? Tell us why you're the experts in your field.
Well, my name is Michelle Dolan, and I've been an occupational therapist for almost 20 years, and I've been working at Emerson Hospital for about 5 years.
Okay.
And we rolled out the program in January, and as occupational therapists, we assess all areas of living and being driving the most complex activity of daily living. We are experts in assessing that skill. And this is my co-partner.
I'm Kristen Keelty. I have been an occupational therapist for 10 years and working for Emerson for 2. And I've been interested in helping our community members have a local place to go for this assessment rather than having to travel to the major rehab centers. So Michelle and I were excited to start the program together.
Great. Now, is this one of a kind or is this a national rollout of a program or?
No, there are other local driving assessment programs, but they're further away.
Okay.
So our rehab director, Terry Enos, had a personal encounter needing to find a family member a driving assessment after a medical change. And the program was so far away that she thought, why isn't there one at Emerson? And so as we started talking more and more about it, we thought it was something that we are missing that we could offer to people in our community.
So who refers the individual to your program?
Typically it is the person themselves who is interested in getting back to driving. They're not sure they're safe yet if it's been something like a heart attack or a stroke. It may be a physician, it may be a family member. Perhaps the whole family has been talking about it for some time in regard to an individual, and they're looking for guidance, and maybe they got our name from someone in the community.
So is this always a medical issue? Can it be just aging, or does it always come from some kind of medical condition that's changed their status?
Could be an accident. The police could say, you know, we should take your license, but we'll have you checked out first, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Oftentimes it's a physician that refers, who knows the person the best, or a family member, or the person themselves saying, I don't feel right. I mean, there are RMV regulations that if you do have a seizure or seizure condition, that you'd be free of seizure for 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
And it is that we are a self-reporting state. There's only 5 nationally that are mandated reporting if you've had a change in your medical status. So the state relies on people to self-report if they've had a change, where they need somebody to really look at, are they safe? Do they need any equipment? Do they need to kind of restrict where they're driving, time of day? So, but we do get a lot of referrals from all different avenues.
Nice, and if I'm not affiliated with Emerson Hospital, can I use your services?
Absolutely.
Yes. Oh, good. Yes. Good, good, good.
It's not free, though. It's going to cost you money.
Okay. It's worth it to keep your license.
What is the program? For instance, there's classroom program, there's driving, testing, and so on. So how do you start? What does the individual do first?
The first thing we do is we speak with them on the phone. We talk to them for as long as we need to. We find out things like what was their diagnosis? Have they had a recent vision exam? Because we don't want to start out the assessment and have them fail the vision, and then we just have to start from square one once they've gotten their vision under control. Mm-hmm. So vision is very important, a current vision exam. We ask about what their needs are. You know, do you drive every day to and from work? Is that what you need to get back to? Do you need to get back to driving on Route 2 or 128? Or do you need to do your banking, your grocery shopping, you know, just in your town, your local driving sector? So the individual's goals are taken into account as well.
So then what? Then I show up at your office, and what do you do with me?
We usually make an appointment for it. We need a doctor's referral first from your physician.
Okay.
And then we make an appointment, and you fill out a questionnaire. We send you a welcome packet that gives you all the steps to, you know, the questionnaire as well as the medical profile. We need your medications and an updated vision. So then you come in the clinic. It takes from 1.5 to 2 hours, and the charge is $300. In the clinical eval, we look at more static testing, what you would normally do on the road, but we want to first make sure what we're looking at and break it down so we can see if there's problems on the road, where it came from. So we look at your vision fitness, your cognitive fitness, and then your physical fitness.
So would I go through some tests? I mean, vision's pretty simple. I think we all know that test, but give me an example of cognitive.
Well, we ask for memory. We ask for your attention. We do about 7 different types of tests. 2 of them involve the computer. You don't have to have computer skills. And we will run the mouse for you, and it doesn't affect the results. So this is a program where it looks at 3 subtests that look at your attention. So there'll be a picture of a symbol of a car or truck, and it quickly moves like you're driving on the road.
Oh.
And so we're looking at how quickly you're scanning, how you're focusing.
Kind of like a video game.
Yeah, and then they...
Driving along.
Right. So then the second test is that same picture that you have to identify between 2 symbols, and then you also have to look at something in your periphery and decide where it is in that location. So we're looking at your, you know, your selective attention, then we look at divided attention, it's called. So it becomes more complex. So we do that, and we do some paper and pencil tests, but it's more, you know, it's looking at your attention and your memory and your problem solving and judgment.
All right, so that's cognitive. And what was the third one you mentioned?
The physical fitness.
Physical, so what does a person have to go through there?
It's not any physical fitness test.
I'm thinking,
like
actually being on a track or something.
Yeah, can you look at the side view mirror?
Right.
Like that?
Yeah, neck range of motion, your shoulders.
Not what I had in mind.
So you don't have to, you know, as we age,
push-ups.
You don't have to do, you know, 180 degrees, but your arm has to be at least around 90 or 70 so you can change your rear view mirror. We look at your strength, and we look at both your arms and your legs, and then, of course, your truck as well. And then we look at sensation, because oftentimes people have peripheral neuropathy in their feet and don't realize I'm not feeling the gas pedal move the gas to the brake. Mm-hmm. So we look at that, and then we look at coordination. We also look at a walking test. It's a speed test. That's a predictor of crash.
How fast basically. You can walk?
How quickly
really?
You walk.
I didn't know that. Why?
So we based a lot of a selection of our tests based on how they correlate to crash risk. So we've built our comprehensive driving eval program around evidence-based tests. So
that makes a lot of sense to me, but how does walking correlate to driving? Do you know?
Can I answer that? Yes,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
I want to take the
whole Your visual processing is really important for driving. You need to be able to see what's out in the environment and quickly process that to know how to respond when you're doing lots of things.
Makes sense.
Driving included. Walking is also included. So if we're telling you walk 8 feet, turn around and walk back, you're taking in this information like, is the ground flat? Are there obstacles in my way?
Yeah. Makes sense.
And they have found that if your speed is above a certain amount of seconds, that those type of people have had a higher rate of crashes.
Crashes?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of fascinating, isn't it? Yeah. So let's say I take the test and I don't do well on the cognitive. Can I retake the test, or is that it?
We would be looking, we're looking to get people who are feeling in their good health at the time.
Okay.
So if someone were to have some kind of infection that was causing them to feel that they were worse than usual, we would want to reschedule.
Okay.
Because we want it to be a good picture.
Fair enough.
So this time of year is good with all the stuff floating around the air and
depends
people
on
not seeing well because their eyes are watery. And
we try
or if
to
they're
help
going
them.
With a little cold or something. So, all right, so it's not a black and white situation.
It's almost never a black and white situation with the driving assessments. We do, the clinical assessment is about 2 hours. And
it's a long time.
It's a long time. We ask people, take breaks when you need them. Here, have some water, get up and walk if you like. And then come back and focus on the task because you want to do your best. No one failure of one test is going to cause someone to fail the whole clinical evaluation.
Got it.
We're able to look at the big picture for someone.
Well, I know we had someone on that does car fit, which fits you to your car, and they had a lot of accessories for the elderly or the somewhat handicapped. So I could see where if a person couldn't turn to see what was happening, car fit could correct that because they had this seat thing that turned you. Mm-hmm. Rather nicely, actually. So,
it's like
do you
a lazy
give people
Susan.
Like yeah, a lazy disc, Susan yeah, for people, yeah, right? And so, if I had specific issues that you felt could be corrected, do you make suggestions about things that can be purchased or how to adjust the seat or whatever to help that person be more effective inside a car?
We definitely do.
Nice.
We also perform a car fit program twice a year. Through Emerson Hospital. We just did ours this last Saturday, part of the Emerson Health and Wellness Expo. And we have some of those gadgets to show, and we can help people figure out where to get them if they're interested.
Okay.
Good. I think it's a great, and I don't think $300 is extraordinarily expensive to keep your license, to adjust what isn't 100%, mm-hmm. and to be able to have some feedback about where you are in relationship to the standard population who's driving. I think that's very reasonable. And then, as you said, you assist. Mm-hmm. So it's not just being tested, it's also a lot of corrective action so that you're at your optimum.
But right. Insurance companies don't cover this.
No, they don't.
Oh, they don't?
No.
So
I object. No,
we
that's
do too.
I don't agree.
Well, we
you
often
don't have
talk,
to agree.
Talk about, you know, you go for your checkup with your eyes, you know, because we all know that.
Yeah.
The RMV now requires you at 75 years old to have an eye check.
I got
to
do it.
Why
don't
I think the automobile insurance company should pay for this? It'd save them a fortune.
It might.
Well, there you go. A
write
little
a
championship.
Yeah. Write a letter.
Write a letter.
Okay, so now you pass this, or you almost pass it. There is also a driving test.
Correct.
That's
in their car or yours?
In the driving instructor's car, because they have controls on their side.
Ah,
they have dual controls.
That's probably a good idea.
Now, if you're an amputee, mm-hmm. you can have a car, and I mean, you could drive a car
correct.
With hand controls or extra feet control, whatever. Mm-hmm. So in that case, would you have to use your own car, or do they have that type of equipment as well?
We use a gentleman by the name of Don Sampson. He's out of the Central Mass office, and he is a certified rehab driver specialist. Mm-hmm. So he was a driving instructor, and then he took the national test by the ADED, which is the National Organization for Driver Instructors, that that he has two type of vehicles. So he would bring mm-hmm. that vehicle to okay. us with those controls. He would also be doing training with them. Once they figure out which equipment is needed, then they would purchase that, and then you would go through a specific vendor, and you would need an assessment form signed by him with the vendor.
Yeah, I had a cousin who had a leg amputated, and he had a hand control for the foot mm-hmm. pedal.
Huh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, are you busy? No discrimination.
The month of May, we have 6 assessments planned.
Okay.
We work Monday and Friday mornings or afternoons if the person really needs it, but the time that we prefer is the morning. And that's a pretty good month.
Huh. And the cost?
It'll never be a full-time program for us. The cost for the clinical assessment is $300, and that includes all of our time speaking with the patient and speaking with the physician potentially and potentially family members, and then sending the information to everyone after the evaluation is over. And it also includes our riding along on the on-road portion of the exam, which is at a later date, and that has a separate fee attached to it. That is usually an hourly rate by the driving instructor or driver rehab specialist, and it's been about $200 for that second part of the test.
Do you have to report back to the Department of Motor Vehicle?
It's a self-reporting state. If somebody, usually what has happened is if somebody is deciding that they need to retire from driving, so first we look at, can we remediate the situation so that they can return to driving? Or do we need to restrict them, or do they need to retire? And of all times right now, since we started the program, people have agreed with the report, so we ask them to discuss it with us and their family members, and they sign off on it, and that report goes to the doctor. But yes, ethically, we would report somebody if we felt that they were going to go against
right.
our rules. Yes. It is not, and the new law with the RMV change, it used to just protect physicians with reporting. It is not anonymous, but we do have immunity. So any healthcare nurse, OT, PT, could report somebody if they're going against medical advice, and they should retire because they're unsafe, because that's what we're all looking is to keep people on the road as long as they are safe, as long as they can be, because it's not age regulated.
Yeah. Right.
It's how your fitness is.
Right. It could be at any age, actually.
Right.
I mean, it could be as simple as don't drive when it's dark.
Well, you mentioned restricted driving, and that's... I am watching elderly people, and it seems that all of them self-impose restrictions. How many and at what age differs, but they drive less far, they cease driving in the evening, they seem to drive to places that they know. So it becomes a route, whereas mm-hmm. I'll just hop in the car and go every now and then. So is that what you mean when you say restricted?
Yes. Yeah.
So is that a different kind of license or?
No. No, the RNV, I guess if they didn't make the vision, I'm not sure if they didn't make the vision requirements of 270, then it is restricted to daytime driving.
Okay.
So that would be noted, because they do have vision restrictions. You have to have peripheral vision of 120. And then you have to have 20/40 for any time driving, and then 20/70 is when you're restricted during the day. Correct? I think so.
It sounds good.
It's on the RMV website.
Okay.
During the day, during good weather, familiar locations, non-peak. Cars are familiar with. Now the new cars too have the GPS, have all this automated distractions, or drive without the radio, drive without, somebody you might go with understands that you need to focus at a certain place if you're going to a new location, where there's other people in your car that they talk loud because they're hard of hearing, and that may distract you, so you can choose to who you have in your car if you're going to a new location and things like that.
So you would sit down with someone and counsel them, make suggestions, and tell them based on the test this would be the optimum situation for them?
That's what we do. Yep. At the end of, if we finish the clinical assessment and we feel that from the information we have already, we know that we're not going to go on to the on-road assessment, we're very careful to provide as many resources as we can, because when people are no longer driving, they can become depressed and isolated. So we want to make sure that we do our best to share the resources that we have with them.
And that program is at the center at 310 Baker Avenue Extension?
No.
No. Yes or no? Yeah.
No.
Where is it now?
It's over at the Emerson Hospital Sports and Specialty Services. at 57 Ornack, across from the hospital.
Oh, okay.
It's a small building, and that's where we do our clinical, and that's also where we start for our road. The address you're referring to is when we run our special events, the AARP class that we hosted last
Very
month.
Good.
So sorry, I think we have to correct our website for that.
Okay,
so
and we will put that across the bottom. Now, there's also a phone number.
Mm-hmm.
You want to tell me what it is so I don't give you the wrong one?
It's 978-287-8244. We'll get you right to our office.
Okay.
And you can leave
and
a message.
We'll flash that on the screen so
okay,
people
great.
Can have it.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Right. Yeah.
So what else do you want to tell us about the program? It's been successful.
Mm-hmm.
How long has it been going on?
Since January.
Yeah.
We opened at the beginning of
January.
So that's
not very long. So if you're seeing six people in May, that's pretty good.
We think so.
Yes.
We think so.
Do you need help?
Oh, as far as therapists?
Yeah.
No, we've got it set up right now so that Michelle will work one day of the week in the driving clinic in addition to her other duties, and I'll work one day in the driving clinic. My other work is on the transitional care unit at Emerson Hospital, which is a rehab unit.
So where does Massachusetts stack up in driving, controlling who drives and taking away licenses? And I know my parents are in Florida and I can make an anonymous complaint and they will follow up on it. And you're saying Massachusetts, you cannot do that. So how liberal are we, or are we like average amongst states, or?
Anyone can try calling the RMV or writing a letter to the RMV about someone if you feel that your neighbor is unsafe, for instance. But you won't be protected from
harassment and legal suits.
It's not private.
Your name, right? It's not anonymous.
So if Michelle calls the registry on me because I am driving unsafely, and I call the registry to say who reported me, I will find out that it's Michelle.
It's her, right? So Michelle probably won't call. But how many states have anonymous versus what Massachusetts has? Do you have any idea where we fall?
I don't.
I don't know the answer to that.
I thought it was very unfair that the medical community could be punished for alerting the motor vehicle department about someone that perhaps can't drive anymore.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What's the potential? Let's say that I had
a
stroke.
Wait a minute. We had a program here where the police chief, town police chief, spoke about this. And he said that they will do it. If you go to the police department and say, I think my cousin is driving poorly, they'll check it out. And you won't, I don't believe that they will use your name. So for safety, the police could do it.
Well, it depends. If I said to the police, why have you been following me? And the police say, well, we had a complaint. I can say, who?
But I don't think it'll work that way.
Well,
I think that the way that it's typically done is someone, maybe it's a law enforcement official, reports to the RMV. The RMV sends a letter to your house.
Right.
That says you have 30 days to come to the registry and have a competency evaluation. And they put you behind the wheel of their vehicle, and they drive with you, and they decide if you're safe or not. And so we want to help people avoid that.
So if I got that letter, I should see you first.
You hopefully will come see us before you
before
get that
letter. But don't you find that people are reluctant to? There's a couple of things. One, I think people are reluctant to face the truth because it might not be good news. And some people don't realize because it's been such a slow slip downhill that they really can't proportion it to say, oh, I'm losing some of my peripheral vision. It happens so slowly, you don't really notice it, or your reaction times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but not all people. We have a friend who gave up his car willingly because he almost hit a pedestrian, and he felt that it was his fault.
Yeah, but he almost hit a pedestrian. That's
almost,
a subtle hint.
Yeah, and he says, that's it, and he sold the car.
But what if but that's a good example. If he hadn't reached a crisis point, he would have stayed in his car where his reaction times were slowing down.
I don't know. I know the man, and I don't think so. But that's immaterial.
You do have people that self-regulate and that know their vision's, you know, if you go to the doctor, failing, or the arthritis is really bothering them, or they have had an obvious you know, medical condition like a stroke. But there are those people who, like you say, go along and it's so rote, it's like eating.
They won't admit
it. You just go to the down to Bedford Center, to the pharmacy every day. But how does your car look? I mean, we often see people and, you know, one whole side is dented. I mean, that might be a sign to yourself, like, I keep hitting the bumper. Why am I keep hitting the bumper? You know, so there's
what's wrong with those drivers on the road?
What's wrong with that bumper?
So you might say, Mom, how'd you get this scratch? How'd you get that? I don't know. And then, you know, that's where the family members need to come around, or if you don't have family in the area, friends. Because there are those people that drive a group of people together. And so, you know, you can, you know, talk to each other, I think, and you have to depend on each other to give honest information.
There are lots of lists of red flags for people to figure out if they should maybe have things looked into.
What are the most common besides your car smashed up?
Getting lost, not being able to find your car, or not being able to figure out how to get back home. If you hear that a loved one or a friend has had that issue, it's something that you might want to have a serious talk with them about. The dents in the vehicle.
Getting honked at while you're in traffic. Mm-hmm. People are beeping at you a lot.
Mm-hmm. Although in Boston, I'm not sure we can count that one, but okay.
Or getting pulled over. And you might get a warning.
How about road rage?
Yeah, I guess getting angry, yeah.
Yeah.
So, but lost is in familiar places.
Lost in familiar places.
Yeah. Have you saved people's license through your council? Have you been able to restructure their behaviors or their patterns so that they can stay on the road? Mm-hmm. Can you give us one example or story?
Of an eval, too, who they just felt their reactions. They were doing their due diligence and just felt their reactions were getting slower. And they were getting more uncomfortable with how good their abilities were on the road. And so they got verification from our program. And that was really rewarding because they were doing it just to be a good citizen. And, but they weren't sure where the boundaries were. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you get your license and you're 13. And our average age is probably 84, maybe 80. Yeah. So who checks with you every now and then?
Nobody.
Nobody, right. So it's
you do.
So that was really nice because she was able to feel more comfortable mm-hmm. back on the road again after going through all the checkpoints and did very well.
Oh, that's sweet.
And
yeah,
she had
I like it.
A lot of, you know, good confidence and then had really good, you know, parameters of what she would, you know.
What do you think of the thought that has come up at a certain age, like 75, re-road test? Everybody at that age. Do you think that makes sense?
I think financially it will never. Financially it's not going to work out, it doesn't seem. New Hampshire was doing that for a while and they've had to stop because it's the bulk of the people that you have to get through that program.
The baby boomers aging. Yeah.
Is too many. What we're really happy about, I think, is folks who have an early cognitive decline, a mild cognitive impairment, that we can get them in and evaluate them and hopefully we start restricting sooner rather than later. So that they start to get the idea and they start to use some of these local resources so that when it gets bad, if it's going to get bad, that it's an easier transition to relying on the local services, which are quite good.
I'm also hearing that you build confidence in people. So when they go back on the road, they understand the consequences of their behaviors and their physicality. And then can apply that to their driving habits. That just seems to make real good sense. And I'm surprised we haven't had a program like this before. It's needed. It's very needed.
Well, thank you for coming.
Yeah, any last comment before we say goodbye to our audience?
Well, I just note that we're always available to talk to anybody who's has questions about family members or themselves. And I applaud you, and we hope more COAs invite whether they're therapists to talk about how to be safe on the road, but also Michelle Elig from the RMV Outreach is a wonderful resource for the RMV restrictions, as well as AARP, the driver safety class, which is run volunteer and it costs you $12 if you're a member for a book, and then the car fit. So if you wrap those all up and do them annually or biannually, I think that will keep people on the road longer and safer.
Nice.
Right?
I agree.
I encourage everyone to take advantage of what we have locally. Be a good, safe driver. Thank you, ladies, for visiting.
making connections, having fun, COA on the air. See you next time.